All right, enough of the boring stuff. Let's get to the fun stuff. How do we actually create a robot? So we have the battle room for if we want to do a battle, but we have the robot menu, and we can go to the robot editor for actually going in and creating this robot. All right, so I'll create a new robot, and when I do this, I can call it just like it's doing there, my first robot. When I do that, it's going to ask for a package name, and so we can put whatever we want to in there. Probably for the purposes of what we're doing in class, we want to put a CS there so that all our robots are in the same group. But normally you could put your initials or something. So I'll go ahead and say okay to that. And then it builds for me a basic robot. My first robot, okay? Now we'll notice immediately as we do this, first of all, it's importing the Robocode library. So it's importing everything from a library called Robocode that allows us to do a bunch of different things. And then it's public class, my first robot, but then it's got this part extends robot. Well, what's that all about? Well, the extends keyword indicates that we're inheriting from the robot class, which means that there's a class in the Robocode library called robot that we're getting a bunch of methods from. So we're not starting from scratch here. There are a bunch of things that our robot can already do built in by virtue of the fact that it extends the robot class. It inherits from the robot class. So we'll see this a number of times, and we'll look at that more in more detail as we go along. So then we have public void run, and this is kind of the main method of the robot. This is the one that happens first, and where we start and what the robot does. So it mentions here my first robot's default behavior. This is what it's going to do as a default. And so then it's got a loop set up that says while true. Now this is kind of a funny loop because what it's saying is while true is true. And so true is always going to be true, meaning this loop is just going to run over and over and over and over and over again as long as this class is in existence. This is the behavior you want it to do the entire time the robot is going. And so you may be saying to yourself, well, what if I want the robot to do different behavior, not the same thing every time? Well, that's fine. You can do that, but you do that by jumping to other methods and toggling the behavior. When do you want it to do what? Does it depend on the amount of energy do you have? Does it depend on how many people are in the room? We can check all those things and then make our decisions based on that. And then you'll see that we go ahead 100, we turn the gun right 360, we go back 100, and we turn the gun right 360 again. So we go ahead 100, back, scan, go back, scan. Now, why is it doing turn gun right 360? Well, if you remember, the radar is attached to the gun. So when it turns the gun right, that also turns the radar right, and 360 degrees means a full circle. And then it can scan other robots. And this is the default behavior of this robot. If we go back to the battle editor and now go grab that bot we just created. Maybe I need to save first. Let me see here. Save this robot. Oh, I need to compile it too. That's the problem. So it says, do you want to create the directory? Yes, I'll create it. That's fine. And then just like any other Java program, we need to go up to the compiler and compile it. So I'll say compiler, compile, or I can do a control B. And that will compile. And if there's an error in there, it'll show up just like it shows up in any other Java program. So I'll compile that, and when I do that, now it should show up as available for me to use in a battle. So if I take those bots that are already in there, and then I go into the CS package that I created, add my first robot, then this will now be part of that battle, and we'll watch the behavior. Okay, I'm going back. And I keep getting shot, so I can't even see my default behavior. Let's start it over again. So forward, back, forward, back, forward, back. And every time it's turning the gun 360 degrees. That's the behavior that was coded into the program. Now it's doing some other things. When it gets shot here, watch what it does. It backs up a little bit more when it gets shot. And I'm doing all right this round. Maybe I'll keep this bot. But it's nice to be able to see that behavior. Just back and forward, back 360, forward 360, back 360, forward 360, and that's the default behavior. Okay, so I'll go ahead and stop that battle, and then we'll come back into our robot editor. Now notice it's calling the ahead method, and there is no such thing in this class. If I scroll through the whole thing, there is no such thing as an ahead method. So how is it calling the ahead method? Well, remember that we've extended the robot class, meaning we've inherited all the methods from the robot class, and so the ahead must come from the robot class. And so if I go to my help and pull up the Robocode API, we'll see what this does. Let me make this... Well, let me guess, you want to be able to see it. Picky, picky, picky. Let me see if I can get this in this window here. Okay, so in the Robocode API, it has all the classes that are in that Robocode library. And so if we scroll down to the R's, there should be a robot class, and there is. So if I click on the robot class, then that will pull up the information for the robot class. Now remember, API is basically the instruction manual for how to use a particular program. And so this is going to tell us, in this robot class, what are the fields? There's an out field. There is a constructor, but the constructor's blank. And then a bunch of methods. And the very first method we look at is the ahead method. So this is one that's been written in that robot class that we get to piggyback on now because we've extended the robot class. And so I just call, let's see here, I just call ahead, and then I pass it a number, and that makes the robot go ahead. I don't have to do any of the code to make it actually animate or change its X and Y coordinate or anything like that. That part's been done in the robot class, and I'm just now extending the robot class and just calling that method. So I call the ahead method and I pass it a 100. Well, what does the 100 represent? If I click on this class, I'll get the detail for it, and it gives me the signature, public void ahead double distance. So it's going to pass in a double that contains the distance, and this immediately moves forward the robot by the distance measured in pixels. So if I pass it a 100, it's going to move 100 pixels. If I pass it 200, it's going to move 200 pixels. This call executes immediately and does not return until complete. And notice it doesn't actually return anything, while the remaining distance move is 0. If the robot collides with the wall, the move is complete, meaning the robot will not move any further. If the robot collides with another robot, the move is also complete if you are heading toward the other robot. Note that the positive and negative values can be given as input, so you could do a negative ahead, which would take you back, right? And then it gives an example. We can move ahead 100, or we can move ahead negative 50, which would move us 50 pixels backwards. And that's the ahead class. That's a little bit of information about how to use the ahead class. And so I say, okay, well, I used ahead and I passed it 100. Let's change that to 200, or let's go 300 even. And let's save this, compile it, and then watch it work, just to prove that it actually does something. So if I restart this now with the newly compiled bots, notice I went ahead way longer than I was. And now this is a bad situation because I just kept going ahead into the wall and RAM fire was taking it to me. And I went back and I'm going way ahead, and then I'm going to go back 100 and then way ahead and then back 100 and then way ahead, maybe. Wow, I died quickly. When Ramfire gets a hold of me, I am in trouble. Okay, now this is going to be kind of boring because now I'm going to run into the wall, back up, run into the wall, back up. Very exciting bot. But that's the behavior, and it's all based on that ahead method, right? And so that's one of the things we can do. We already know another thing we can do, which is turn gun right. And so if I go back to my robot class, because that's what I've extended, down to the turn gun right method, then it will give me some information on the turn gun right. Okay, so public void turn gun right, double in degrees, immediately turns the robot's gun to the right by degrees. This call executes immediately and does not return until it's complete when the angle remaining in the gun's turn is zero. Notice that both positive and negative values can be given as input, where negative values means the robot gun is set to turn to the left instead of the right. So we could make a decision to go left by turning the gun right to a negative 90 degrees. Which may be more useful than you think it is, just right there. Sometimes you don't know how many degrees exactly. You're using a variable, and so you want to use the variable and just use one call. So turn gun right. You don't want to figure out whether I have to use the turn gun right or the turn gun left. You can just turn the gun right at a certain number of degrees, and if that number of degrees happens to be negative, then it will turn the gun left instead. So it's actually more useful than you think. And then the back. There's a back method. So if I go back to my API, again, we're in the robot class. I come down into the method summary, and there's a back that says this immediately. Wow. Whew. What happened there? I'm telling you. This is hard enough because your brain's going like, you know, just like 0.2 seconds ahead of your mouth. And then your mouth's going pretty fast, too, as you're trying to keep up with this. Don't try this at home, kids. This immediately moves the robot backward in a distance measured in pixels, so we pass it a certain number, and that's the same thing. If we pass it a negative number, it will actually move forward, and that's how the back works. And so you can look at this list of methods that we have available to us. We have a do-nothing method. We have a fire method, where we pass it the power of a bullet, and it will fire immediately. Fire a bullet. All right, and we'll talk about the difference between some of these methods. We can get the battlefield height and get the width so we know we don't crash into a wall because we're measuring before we go of where we want to go. Get the energy, to be able to get our energy so we can make a decision based on how much energy we have. That's a method that's available to us using this robot class and the accompanying methods. Get the gun coin rate, get the gun heading, get the height, get the name, get the others. This one's useful. How many others are still in the game? And then we can make decisions based on that. If get others is less than 3, then behave differently than if there were 6 in the game, right? A long time ago, the very first UCF, you know, the mixed martial arts, came around, and me and my buddies decided to get it on pay-per-view. So we got it. It was the very first one. It was going to be really interesting because you're going to get all these people, some karate, some boxing, some, you know, wrestling, and all these different disciplines. And we were curious about who would come out on top. And the person that came out on top was a guy named Royce Gracie from Brazil. And he was a grappler. And at that time, it was funny because he wasn't the biggest or the strongest, but grappling in that situation was the way to win the one-on-one battle, right? And now when you watch mixed martial arts, it's a staple. You have to be able to grapple. But grappling would be absolutely no good if you were fighting people in a group, right? Anyway, so different strategies for different situations. We'll talk a little bit more about that and do some programming in the next video. Spencer out.